call this work session to order. First thing to discuss is the minutes.
Make a motion to approve the minutes.
Second.
Just give me 1 minute. Any other comments on them? I don't see that I took any notes. No, any other comments? We have a motion to approve the minutes in a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Very nice job again.
Yep.
Yep. Okay. So let's go to, well, the table, that's still going to continue table till next further notice?
Yes, at least. But I was informed by Zach Nursinger in the planning office that they had received communication from a professional engineer who was hired to go out and witness the protests. So.
Okay. Moving forward. No action necessary on that because it's table till further notice. So let's go to tonight's agenda and see if we have any questions for clarification. Okay, number one. Oh, by the way, first of all, we have one that was, number two was pulled, is that correct?
Correct.
For a month?
Well, till June.
If anybody's here, sir?
Sir?
Are you here for which application?
I'm here to just, I want to see the signage for the item number four.
Okay.
Oh, okay. No, number two has been canceled, that's why we.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's just adjourned at the request of applicant until the June meeting.
Correct.
All right, very good. Okay, any questions for clarification on number one? Okay, how about questions for clarification on number three? Wow.
It's Carol's.
That's a question for clarification? Is it Carol's?
Well, no, I was going to say we do have some.
That's right, we do
paper
have some,
that we got that I would add to.
Okay.
The application, sir.
And I think you may have just received something for number one, too.
Yes, yes.
Because I wasn't sure.
Put it in. Yep.
Some of them, I think.
So there was an addition to number one, and there was an addition to.
Well, let's go back to number one then. What did we get?
It was just a letter.
It was an email.
Oh, with the photos from a park.
With the photos, right, yeah.
Oh, well, that, you sent that out a couple days ago, right?
Right, but Joe and Carol just got it tonight.
Okay.
Why? Not an email you listed?
You may not have seen it.
What?
Did you see it, maybe, or did you miss it?
I saw it.
Do you want to be on the electronic participation?
Yes, I would like it.
We will put you there.
I'll have Mary look at it.
So no questions on number three?
That's the, yes, that's.
What did we get on that? The, just this, having children around always makes the neighborhood more, that one?
Yeah, and it's a whole bunch of people that signed
the support letter.
Like it, yep.
Okay.
Support letters, I didn't read them myself.
Yeah. Any questions on number four?
And I think you just got that.
We just got it.
Today there from the planning office.
I got a question on the preschool.
Oh.
They're alleging it's a home occupation.
No, it doesn't
home
qualify.
Business?
It doesn't qualify as a home business because it's a, she doesn't live at the site, but a daycare, preschool, nursery school, or conditional permit uses in the residential zoning district.
The site map for number four is not depicting accurately what's going to happen for this application. Because there's no addition. This is what was previously from 2009,
that's,
right?
After the conversation I had with you, I printed up that previous site plan approval, which shows the locations of the other townhouse units that are going to the north and then somewhat to the.
Except for this one, probably.
Right. Yeah. Well, that one goes away.
Yeah.
That one has to go away because this is the footprint of the new addition.
It just goes in the north now, right? That one little section goes out to the north.
The,
let's see.
The new one.
The new one.
The new will go right here.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay. Well, that's
and then there'll be the townhomes
right.
Whoever go. Yep.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep, but quite honestly, in the discussions we've had with the applicant within the last 5 or 6 months, mm-hmm. I'm not entirely sure if that type of a housing is going to go forward. I don't.
What is it, like apartments, right?
They're townhouse units, they're intended to be sort of, well, they were intended to be.
Attached to a building so they can go in and eat and use the entertainment.
Yeah, they could use the services, whether it be custodial, kitchen services, going to the cafeteria and the dining room and things like that. And it gives them ability to transition from a traditional single-family residence where there's almost no resources for them to an environment where there are resources and other services available.
Very pretty places, right?
Yeah, it is, very nice.
All right, how about number five, any questions for number five?
That's yours, Mike, that's that sign, I believe, right?
Okay.
When was that heard last?
Was that a year ago?
It was, if not a year, but pretty close to within a couple days of a year.
Yeah, okay.
Do you have a copy of the resolution for that?
The previous resolution?
Yeah.
It was denied.
Yeah, I know, I have a copy of the previous resolution.
I think it was.
Well, we have plenty of time if you want to, do you want that?
Yeah, I'd like to.
Yeah. All right, well, let's just, so there's nothing else to cover at the work session, so let's just adjourn the work session for now and reconvene for the hearing in about 20 minutes, so we have time. Okay?
Sounds good.
All right, thanks.
I'll be right back.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to a regularly scheduled meeting of the Penfield Zoning Board of Appeals. Tonight's meeting is going to take place in two parts. The first part will be our public hearings, and we will ask the applicant to come up to the podium give us name and address, and then explain to the board members why the relief requested should be granted. Once the applicant is done with the presentation, board members will likely have some questions, and then we'll invite anyone in the audience to come up and speak about the application and do the same thing, give us name and address so that we can have a complete record. After the public hearings are adjourned, we will take a brief recess, usually at Joe's request, and then we will reconvene in the back of the room to deliberate on tonight's agenda items and tend to any unfinished business that the board may have. Members of the public are certainly welcome to both the public hearings and the deliberations, although generally speaking, the deliberations are times reserved for conversation amongst board members with staff or with council. Agenda tonight is, I would say, average. So you, as I just said, you're certainly welcome to stay. If for whatever reason you don't want to stay or you can't, feel free to call Allison or Harold or anyone in the zoning department tomorrow to find out what action, if any, the board took on a particular item. Every month, I'd like to point out that we feel the town does a good job of notifying neighbors that live near and the property that is a subject of an application, that the application is going to be heard by this board. And the town does that so that neighbors are fully informed of their right to come in and speak about this. And the town does it in many ways, including postcards to people if you live within a certain distance of the application. We require the applicant to post a sign, post it on the internet, and then post it on bulletin boards in some areas throughout the town hall. So thanks, Joe. I would point out that application number two, which is Anthony Pilato's request for a conditional use permit to allow a dog grooming business at 1617 Creek Street, has been adjourned at the request of the applicant to next month. I don't know if anybody's here on that one, but I wanted you to know that. Come back now, June, do we have the date, June?
15th.
It's not the third Thursday, as it usually is.
It's a Monday.
Monday night, June 15th. Okay? You're welcome. All right, with that being said, I'd ask everyone to rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Harold, may we have the first application, please?
Application number one, John Mueller, 37 Watersong Trail, Webster, New York, 14580, requests an area variance under Article 3-3-35-E of the code to allow a pool cabana with less setback at 37 Watersong Trail.
The property is owned by John Mueller and Christina Gulla and is owned R-1-20. This is SBL number 094.01-6-29. This is application number 15Z-0023.
Okay.
Good evening. I'm Christina Gulla.
And I'm John Mueller with the homeowners at 37 Watersong Trail. And you have the packet in front of you with the timeline and the information we put together along with the photographs, which we've displayed up here on the board. And we'd just like to highlight three items regarding this request. Number one, the structure was placed there in 2012. So it's been there for quite some time. At the time, there was no building whatsoever behind us. The seven houses that are on the property now were constructed last year. When we did place the shed, it was waist-high weeds. And using the plot map that was provided by our builder and to the best of our ability with the stakes that were out there at the time, we did our measurements and placed the structure where we thought it would be within the proper town code and setback. I think what happened, given the weeds, there was a stake missing, a pin missing that we only located later when we had our plot resurveyed when this issue came to light several years later. So I think that's where the error was. So that's point number one. Secondly, we'd like to point out we've tried to the best of our ability as homeowners to follow the town code. We've applied for all the permits. We've paid the fees. We've called for inspections. We've really tried to do this the right way and locate it properly in accordance with the town code. And then thirdly, we'd just like to point out that we've also done some research on what it would take to move the structure. We've obtained estimates from our fencing contractor, our landscaper, several companies that have the type of equipment that might be able to even move this type of a structure. Those estimates are about 1,500, although I think that's almost on the low side. So it would be very much of an economic hardship for us to undertake moving it at this point in time.
Okay. Yeah, may I call you John? Oop, go ahead.
Did you receive the email from Allison?
No.
No, right. I did not.
We'll give you a copy here.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's a gentleman. It's in back of you, and he requested it to be moved. Okay.
So, what are we to do with this?
It was just information.
Just wanted to make sure.
Okay. We want you to have all the information that we have.
Okay. Presentation.
Oh, perfect. Well, thank you. Appreciate
that. So I guess I'll start off by saying, you know, mistakes have certainly been made all around here, okay? And let's start with where your shed actually sits, and that is 3.2 feet from the property line, because you're asking for a variance of 6.8 setback, right?
Yeah, that's at the closest corner. The opposite mm-hmm. corner is actually further from the lot line. I know it looks symmetrical, but there's actually three lots that come together. This is, again, part of the confusion. It's not a straight symmetrical line. So,
okay,
but you are correct.
I see what you're saying. Yep, over yep. here, mm-hmm. too. How much room is between your shed where it is now and your white fence? How much room is there?
Between the pool cabana and the fence, it's about 3 feet now, I think.
3 feet, okay. And so even if you just push it back, you still need a variance.
We looked
correct?
Into that option, and mm-hmm. even moving it back up against the fence will not meet the setback requirement.
Yeah, it seems like, you know, you said $1,500 when I went out there and looked, or dollars, I should not be a plumber all the time, that it was kind of low, because I don't even know how they get back there anymore. And I guess that's
why I don't either.
I requested you to put up the pictures. The biggest yeah. one that I looked at was you originally set up would be this one where you.
Yep.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And that one shows where you put the groundwork for it.
Yep.
And the grass looks at least more than 10 foot from the bushes, so I assume that that's what you figured, your lot line was past that.
Yeah, and the stakes were, you know, located out there in those weeds and.
Right, and that's.
We measured the best.
Where one of the mistakes was made, right?
Yep.
And the other one was, is the picture of how you put it in there.
Yes.
I mean, look at the size of that trailer. I don't know if the cameras can catch it, but it certainly was a huge trailer.
Yeah, this is a 12 by 18 Amish-built shed, so it's quite
gorgeous.
Well-built,
yeah.
And very difficult to move at this point.
And now there's a fence about 4 foot away from your property, so I would have no idea how you could even move it, or it would be prohibitive to me. Anyway, I guess I'd ask you, you talked about when you went out to paint it. What color did you paint it?
We painted it to match the color of our house,
okay.
Both trim and siding. So I took a paint swatch and matched it to the siding on our house to, again, try to help it blend in as well.
Uh-huh. And actually, it's fairly close to the neighbor's house.
It is.
Color.
Yep.
So in the beginning, when I drove out there, I thought it was his shed, and I was looking at the wrong property.
Mm-hmm.
But there's no electric to the
There's no
there,
electric,
right?
No, sir.
Okay. And Harold, they talked about a fire pit. You said somewhere about a fire pit. Is it something we have to bring up tonight, or is that? I mean, that's.
I mentioned something about a fire pit.
I imagine a fire pit.
It was somewhere in the.
Yeah, somewhere in the documents,
package.
But the fire pit is inside the fence.
Inside
right?
The fence.
Yeah,
so I don't
part
know.
Of the pool area, I thought.
In the pool area, yes.
So it really doesn't.
It doesn't.
Okay.
Well.
Yeah, I know.
Obviously, we should be using appropriately, and I'm going to put that fire safety because it is. Building Safety Month, if you didn't know that already. And
it was
a proclamation that was signed
announcement.
By the town supervisor, and it's a national
right.
organization.
Absolutely.
So be careful
yes.
in all your endeavors and
yeah, the
fire
pit's probably 50 feet from the structure.
But you'd be surprised. It's,
oh, yeah.
It's,
uh-huh.
it's a difficult time of the year for
mm-hmm.
fires.
Mm-hmm. I understand.
Okay, that's all the questions I have, Dan.
What is the square footage of the cabana?
Oh, it's a 12 by 18 structure.
Okay, and what we've heard it described as a shed, and then in the application it says cabana. So I guess there's a difference. What is it, a cabana?
Yeah, we're using it for pool equipment storage primarily.
Okay. And why did you decide that size was the appropriate size?
Just so we would have adequate space to store the pool equipment.
Is it filled up when you use it? I guess in the winter, is it?
In the winter, yeah, pretty much, yes.
All right, and why did you pick that location, forgetting about the setback issue for me.
Yeah.
Why did you pick that general
really just
area?
Because it would be wasted space. We knew we were you know, we had the yard fenced already, so we wanted to make sure that we had an adequate backyard that was fenced, and then the structure just beyond that. So.
Okay, and if the pin that you were using as guidance were in fact correct, how many feet would there have been from the setback? Do you know any ballpark figure?
It would have been like 11 to 12 feet.
Okay. Since you have built that, there is now a home behind you.
Correct.
And from the photos, what I see is the doors to your cabana open toward your neighbor's house.
Yes, correct.
Why did you put the doors on that side versus facing your pool?
Just so we would have more space, so there
towards
wasn't obstruction up against our fence.
Okay.
To get things in and out of.
And to get things in and out of.
Sure.
Not ever expecting a fence to be located within 4 feet from it.
Okay.
There's a field there.
All right. Well, and that's why I asked, because
yeah.
you put the doors opening that way because you need space, and
yep.
you figured you had 10 or 11 feet.
Right.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So that,
exactly.
to me, demonstrates that you know, that was a good faith belief on your part that you had plenty of room to open those doors and get things
yeah,
in.
Yeah, I think that's depicted in this picture as well. You can see the amount of space here where the doors open on the left side
yeah.
versus the amount of space we would have up against our white fence here on,
yeah.
on this side.
Yeah. Okay. Now, as Joe said, we do encounter on occasion, frankly more common than folks would probably think, we do encounter instances where items have been built or placed that are in violation. One of the things that we try our best to do is to go back in time and look at the application as if the structure weren't there, but honestly, that's not always practical. So we do ask people to demonstrate to us what would the cost of moving be, and I think you've done that. But we also certainly have to take into consideration all the factors as well. So I would ask you, if you could just generally touch on the issues of, do you think this has any adverse effect on any of the neighboring properties? Are there other sheds or cabanas in the area? Just touch a little bit on that.
Yeah, there are definitely other sheds in the area, several in-ground pools in the area as well, so it's not uncommon to have the structure here. And I think it's important to note, too, that that the houses were built, you know, from the Homorama subdivision, knowing that the structure was already located there, and so folks knew what they were getting into when Homorama was constructed.
Okay, and I did see the email. I think that you guys probably just saw, and you know that certainly it's a good view in the sense of it mm-hmm. demonstrates what the neighbor is looking at.
Yep.
But really, that view wouldn't change all that much if the cabana were moved back 6 feet. I understand.
Mm-hmm. And there is buffering.
I'm sure we may hear, but I certainly understand the concern. But mm-hmm. sometimes the reality is the wish is that the structure weren't there at all.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And you do have a right to have one if it's placed mm-hmm. in the right location. So.
And I just want to add to that, you know, there were conversations with the person that sent this email. I think he's here and going to speak. And you know, we also had said this was not our intent to make anybody's life difficult by any means. This was not our intent when we put the shed there, and that we thought we did everything to the best of our ability. You know, and here's where we are today.
And so, as Harold can attest too, when Homorama was there last year, we worked with, you know, the director, the CEO of Homorama, and to try to get the shed moved while there was equipment on site. So we did look at options and ways of trying to move mm-hmm. it, you know, before the construction was all complete. But now, given the finished construction, the fence, the everything else that's now back there, it's really going to be impossible to do. To any movement whatsoever.
Okay. Any other board questions? Nope. Anyone in the audience? Okay.
Thank you.
I'm Chris Grecki for Mayor's Garden. I'm the person directly impacted by this. Just to give some background, which doesn't probably matter with your decision because the rules are the rules, but when we bought our home, that shack was there. It was Y, and they told us that there was agreement to move it. Now,
who's they?
Landmark Builders. Before we bought it, they said we asked about it because it was sticking out.
Is that your builder?
It's the builder of Homorama. Before I put a contract on it, and as we were going through the contract, I go, "Are you going to be moving that? Are they going to move that?" And he said, "Yes, it's not, and it's in violation." Now that's him saying it. What that means, I don't know what that means. You know,
okay.
It's a builder trying to sell us his property, obviously too. But I want to show you some pictures. Then I want to talk about the cost of moving it, too, because it is a fence that could be moved. It is a thing that could have a forklift move it out probably pretty easily. There's builders in the community that own a lot of the properties, too. I'm sure maybe people could help kick in on it. But let me give you some pictures as to what it looks like now. So this is the first one where you'll get a view. You can see how close it is to the property. Here's the second one. And then some of these are just, I didn't realize you blew them up on a camera.
There's some clips on this side.
Yeah.
How many more pictures you got?
One more. Well, I'll just leave it though. So you can see from these how close how close it is and how big it is. And then when you're looking at it from our property, one thing that stands out right here is, you know, we have a beautiful backyard like we all do. It's, yeah, it just stands out when you come in. It's just right there smack. It looks like it's our shed, and it's not our shed or our shack or whatever it is. But the one that I really want to show you that really shows you really what's going on here is this one right here. So this one right here, you can see it was put on the outside of the pool, so you really don't have to see it. The pool area here is beautiful, nice, but your shed is on the outside. So when you're enjoying your pool, you're not looking at your cabana. So I have to look at it, basically. So my backyard looks at the cabana, where he's free to sit out. And I understand the history of when he put it up there. And I don't want him to have a big financial burden to move it, but that's kind of what you're looking at. Now, when we all go to sell our properties down the line, someone else is going to come look at that too and go, what is that, you know? And I haven't seen any of those in the neighborhood right now. And I'll argue that it does impact other property values, other people, because these builders are building more homes, and then they're going to drive down. There's a lot right across the street that's going to be looking at this too, right across the street from mine. So I'm just saying, it just, you know, if the rules were the rules and there were mistakes, is there a way to help John rectify and fix it and be in accordance and be, you know, meet the rules of the ordinances as they are for everybody else? And then my question would be, if we approve it here, does that mean we can all get approval to have these on someone else's property? Because, you know, it's a rule, so.
Well, can I ask you a question?
Sure.
Where would you like them to move it? I mean,
well, if you could reverse it and put it 10 feet and put it behind the fence. That's.
Well, I mean, in order for him, we can't force him to put it behind the fence. All we can, do is have him move it back to 10 foot away from your property.
Yeah, the email he sent me said that if he had to move it, he would still have it facing me. But if it's back, at least it would be back 10 feet. It's not going to look like it's.
Well, no, it would actually be back only 6 foot.
6 feet, yeah, exactly.
Okay, so, I mean, looking at your picture up there, I can understand what the problem is. But if they move the back 6 foot, I mean, does it really take away anything from that shed? I mean, you're picking up 6 foot more in front of the shed. So picture it pushed up against the fence and 2 more feet.
Yeah. It's what that, well, I guess I'd ask the town, because we came up with that ordinance for a reason, 10 feet. If we came up for a reason, you guys said it there, so 3 feet wasn't adequate. If it was, we would have said the ordinance is 3 feet, not 10 feet.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that's all I said.
And that's a valid point, except it doesn't apply as much to views, to be quite honest with you. But you're correct. 10 feet was chosen to be put in the code for reasons.
Yeah, and again, I don't, no, we're not trying to have a hardship with somebody, but you know, our understanding is it just definitely stands out. When you look at the property values, we're building some amazing homes, and the community is amazing, all the existing homes that were there. Mm-hmm. And it's just, does it set a precedence that we could all just put something out there in the middle?
Wouldn't it stand out just as much, though, if it was moved back 6 feet, if it's still on the outside of the fence, even if the fence was 6 feet back?
Until I saw it, I wouldn't know, but it would be 6 feet farther back. It would be not look like it's sitting in my, like someone mentioned when you went out there, I think, Joe, I can't see without my glasses, that you thought it was mine because it's so close.
Well, yeah, the way it's oriented.
Yeah, if you put it closer in there, it's really going to be his shed, not my shed. Now, the appearance is it's my shed.
Can I ask you, who put the fence up on your property? And when was it installed?
It was installed, when we closed the house, we installed it right after. And
the,
I had to get
the builder did, or you?
No, we hired we hired a fence company through the builder. Yeah. We have dogs, so you know, we want it fenced in similar to he's had his fenced in. So we just followed the rules and put it around because we thought that was moving.
Because the builder told you, right?
Yeah. Well,
I know. That's why it says a lot of.
And I think John, in fairness to him, it sounded like the Home Arama people were going to help him move it at one point, and they didn't come through on it. And then everything goes up, everything closes, and he's got his shed right there. It would have been nice because they have all the equipment, the builders. Probably could have taken his fence post out, lifted it to 6, and put the fence back around it. And even if it's facing me, it still would have been back. I thought that was a really good solution, but they didn't seem to come through to help him move it. Because that it is a lot of money. I totally understand that.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Any other questions of this gentleman?
Do I just take these or?
Well, it's up to you. If you want to leave them, that's fine.
Yeah, I think some of them I think were emailed to us, but there's pictures.
We should have them actually, at least a copy.
Yeah, I'll leave.
Great. Okay. Anyone else in the audience care to speak about this?
Hi, I'm Johnny. It's Tommaso, 8 Watersong Trail, also representing the builders of the development. This home in the Home Arama was not built by Anthony Tommaso Home, who is the developer of the development, as you guys probably know, as well as John's house was built by Arena Construction. So when we transferred the lot, they were the builder and did everything according to your specifications as far as what's required by the town. When we did Homorama, I do have to say, Chris, prior to with Landmark, who was a different builder in the Homorama, they did work with Rick Herman. I was not privy to the conversations that they had with John and Christina, but I know they did try at that time to do it. I don't know why it wasn't done. Maybe they can address that a little bit better. My only concern from our standpoint, from the sales standpoint for me as a sales representative there, is just, again, abiding by the town of Penfield rules. I don't know if they did receive a permit from the town of Penfield to put the cabana there originally. I don't know that. I should have asked that before I came up here tonight.
They did.
They did.
Right.
Okay, so for us, I mean, we're closing on a house on Tuesday, and we went through a rigorous C of O inspection today that we had to abide by everything as well. My concern is just we have 40 more lots in there, and I'm just worried about the next person and next person and next person getting a permit or cabana or shed that's not within the regulations. So this, of course, impacts a lot of the neighbors that are in there. It's been there. I see the confusion. When the road wasn't there, it was just open land. Some of the neighbors closer to 5 Mile have the same situation where there's no houses behind them, and I know they cut a lot more grass, and they tend to extend their yards, of course. So I can understand the mistake. I just don't know, again, from Chris's standpoint, he's invested a lot of money as well, and I know it is kind of right in his fence. So I don't know, again, it's a very tough situation. I know they've all been dealing with it for the last 6-8 months. And I know that Rick Herman from the home builders took the lead from the development or from the home builder side to create a nicer feel back there for Landmark, who was a builder before he sold it to these guys. So again, my concern is just the setback requirements for the future. Property.
Are you the developer that set the pins out there?
I'm not the developer that set the pins out there.
Okay.
We actually sold
was part of the problem to begin with.
Right. But we actually sold a lot to Arena Construction, so they had to do their own surveying to place the house. We only had, as the builder and real estate rep, we only had architectural approval, which we approved their plan because it was a beautiful house. So we only had architectural approval. So the transfer from Anthony Tomaso Homes to Arena Construction was early on with the lot transfer. And then John and Christina had to do whatever surveys they had to do, probably for their banking or whatever mortgage that they received. So we were kind of not involved in that, unfortunately. But from an overall standpoint, we just want to make, our goal there is, of course, to abide by the rules and try to keep all the, as much eyesores as we can in there. Of course, sheds are allowed or cabanas, I believe one per structure. We have a few deed restrictions that we placed on Watersong itself where we allow for a shed or outbuilding, but it has to abide by Town of Penfield regulations. So, and it can't be of metal and, that type of thing. So that's kind of what, just to come up here, it's a very tough situation and a tough, decision on your end. I just don't know, again, if maybe it could have been done at the Homorama time. I'm not sure of that conversation. Okay.
Well, the concerns you have, John, are legitimate, and I can assure you most of the time we deal with applications before the structures are built. It happens. We had probably 4 months ago, 5 months ago, we had a young couple away on their honeymoon, and the husband's dad, who's a contractor, built a deck for them as a wedding gift, and it was in violation.
Wow.
So there's a person with the greatest of intentions that messes up, and here we are having to deal with it. And that's our, I'm not complaining. I'm just acknowledging that stuff does happen, by and large, things go pretty well, I think, for the most part. But I appreciate your addressing the concerns, and I think you can have confidence that as that wonderful development continues to grow, that we won't have things like this very often, if ever, anymore.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Anyone else care to speak about this application? Okay, thank you all very much, folks.
Application number 2 again was not withdrawn but adjourned by the applicant. I'm not sure if there was somebody who came in just a minute ago.
Application number three, Lauren Seaver, 1708 Empire Boulevard, Webster, New York, 14580, requests a conditional use permit under Article 10-10-4 and Article 3-3-36-K of the code to allow a yoga preschool at 1653 Creek Street. The property is owned by Christine Puschkin and is zoned R-1-20. This is SBL number 108.19-1-7. This is application number 15Z-0020.
Hi, I'm Lauren Seaver, and I'm at 1708 Empire Boulevard, and I am hoping to open my preschool program at 1653 Creek Street. It's a cooperative preschool program for kids that incorporates yoga and movement, and I'm actually running it right now out of a location in the city. And I actually have some pictures here just to show you. These are the current pictures of our current location. And we typically have 6 to 9 kids, but I'm hoping to have up to 12, but no more than 12. And these are pictures of the location that we're hoping to have it at 1653 Creek Street. So these are just some images of it. And I wanted to highlight the driveway because there's a lot of space for people if they were coming and dropping off their kids and then to pick them up. So right now, I'm hoping to have us have a 2.5-hour program in the morning, Monday through Friday, between 9 and 11:30. And I also put in there for a possibility in the future of an afternoon program that would be 12:30 to 3 p.m. Because we're such a small program and we're relatively quiet, I don't see this really highly impacting the neighborhood. And we do have a rolling arrival, usually between 9 and 9:15. So I feel that there's really adequate space in the driveway for those cars to come through with parents. And so I don't think it'll impact traffic at all. And a lot of the families are within walking distance, actually. We have some new people enrolled for the fall who are hoping it'll be here too. And I just think it's not gonna be that big of a deal. And we're mostly inside, and there's a beautiful backyard as well here. But I also brought to you all some letters from various neighbors. I did go around the neighborhood and ask neighbors what they thought, and I got any concerns that I could from them. And I actually brought those questions to Joe, and he gave me great responses that I shared with them. So, but most of the people were very positive, and then the people who were unsure said they were satisfied with the responses that he gave, and that's all in here. I also have a few letters from parents who are either parents who are hoping to have their children come in the fall and parents from this year as well, just saying how they feel it will be a positive addition to the neighborhood and not negative in any way, so.
Any board questions?
Okay, do you own this home?
This is my mom's home. And she's here.
And you don't live there?
I do not live there.
Does she live there?
She does.
Okay, and is it a single-family home?
It's a single-family home with it's an in-law addition that's part of it.
Are they separated?
They're separated with there's like a closet between them.
Just a closet so you can go back and forth?
You could.
You could?
Yes.
I take it she doesn't? Does she just try to stay?
I mean, she does if she needs to go over there.
Okay.
Yeah, sorry.
But the place is all empty now? It's just going to be your preschool in there?
Yes.
And could you describe the inside for me?
Yeah, it's beautiful. There are wood floors, and here are a couple pictures of it. It's got a larger space, a larger room. The total is probably 750 square feet of the whole place, but it's like a living room, dining room space that is empty, and we put, for these pictures, put in some of like preschool type stuff that will be in there. And then there's a second room, which was the bedroom, which would now be used as a yoga room because this program incorporates yoga into everyday's activities. And then there's a small bathroom as well.
Are you, why are you moving from where you are now?
You know what, right now, we're in a great location in the city. We're at a yoga studio, and the problem is every day we have to take out everything and then bring it out the next day, because there are yoga classes there as well. So it's beautiful, but I really am hoping for a more permanent space where we can have tables and chairs that we don't have to pack up in a closet. And I think that's, and this location is just beautiful. And I also feel the city's a hard place to have a preschool program because of UPK, and there's a lot of competition. So I'm hopeful that this will be good for just my business as well.
And are the ages of these children, what, from 3 to 5
three
or something?
3 to 5, yeah.
Okay. And how many employees are you going to be having?
Me? And my mom volunteers right now. It's a co-op, so the parents always volunteer.
Okay.
I'm very lucky.
And how many rooms did you say how many rooms there
yep,
were?
Yep, there are 2 rooms and a bathroom.
Okay, and the classes will be 2.5 hours?
Yeah.
Okay. And the hours of operation?
9 a.m. to 11:30 a.m. And then if we ever did an afternoon session, I'm not planning on one right now, but if we did, it would be 12:30 p.m. to 3 p.m.
Okay. You've asked till 3 o'clock. If you say 3 o'clock, you have to be finished by 3 o'clock.
Okay.
So would you like to extend that
maybe
possibly?
Maybe I might say 3:15 just to make sure everyone's out.
Yeah. Well, if you do end up with 12 children like
yeah.
you're hoping, do you think 3:30 would probably be more practical?
Sure.
Okay.
Right now, they usually go out by 11:45 at our other location. We do a 9 to 11:30. So, but yeah, that's good to have.
And do the parents usually stay?
Sometimes they do. So we always have at least one parent volunteer, but some of the other parents will stay. But often, a lot of parents also just drop them off. So.
And what about food? Do you feed them?
The kids bring a snack. One parent brings a snack, so we have food during it.
And drinks too? Do they?
They bring water.
They bring water.
Yeah, water bottles.
Okay. Do you sell anything there?
No.
Okay. Now you said most of the classes are indoors, but some would be outdoors.
Well, we might go outside for part of the time to play in the yard.
Okay. And where in the yard would you go?
In the backyard. And we are considering looking at putting up some sort of a temporary fence within the bounds of regular backyard permits. I've actually talked with Allison about it a little bit, about what the rules are.
That's what I was going to suggest, that you do have a fence, because Creek Street is very busy,
yes.
and if you've got 9 children running around with just you and a volunteer,
yeah.
it could be pretty difficult.
Yes.
Okay. Now, your ingress and egress, you said you had a circular driveway.
Mm-hmm.
And how wide or how long is that circular driveway?
I know. I hope it's on. Maybe it says it on the. Sorry.
No, not yet.
Why don't you say it runs to the length of the house? Because it does run from one corner of your house that you can
yes.
come in, and you can leave from the other corner of your house. So,
yes.
however, how long your house is. That's
yes.
how long the driveway is.
It does. It runs the length of the house.
How large is the property?
I think it's 3/4 acre, or slightly less than 2/3 of an acre.
Okay, great.
I scaled the driveway width to be 20 feet.
20 feet? Is that the width? And the length is
no, it's actually 98 foot the front of the property. So
yeah,
one is one section's on one corner and one section's almost on the
yeah,
other
the,
corner.
The actual length is kind of hard to scale because
yeah,
because
it's curved.
Yes.
It's
yeah.
curved, but it's 20 foot wide. So
yeah,
in essence,
so two cars could
side by side.
Yeah,
oh,
two
yeah.
cars could
at
go
least two
by
can
each
go,
other
yep,
at the
absolutely.
And if what about the parking spaces? These parents that might stay.
There's. How many cars have we had in there before? I mean, for family things, we can fit a lot of cars in there. And actually, in the picture here, there are 3 right here. And you can see, I mean, there's still a lot of space. So I really think there, we could easily, we've probably fit a good, we fit 10 cars before. So it's a nice wide driveway.
And do you think there will be any impact to present or future uses?
I don't think so.
Okay. And you feel it's compatible with the general area?
Oh, I do.
Okay. And what about the noise level with the children?
It's, we're really not that loud, because it's, I mean, right now with 6 to 9 kids, it's just not that loud. It's kids laughing and having fun, but, you know, we're doing our work, we're doing our yoga, we're, and as these pictures kind of show, it doesn't get that loud, and that is noted in some of the letters, too.
I was going to ask you, are the neighbors on both sides of you, did they write letters?
The neighbors on one side did write a letter, and the neighbor behind us did, and the neighbor to the right didn't, but he said as long as it doesn't impact the property value, he's comfortable with it.
Looking in, the neighbor on your right, did they write a letter?
No. They're the ones who said it.
Because that was the one that'd be most impacted, okay. And you have clear sight distance. Some of these questions are normal conditional use that we need for the record. Buffering, proposed generation of odors. We don't think there are going to be any noxious odors. Outside of what you're suggesting, Dan.
They are usually potty trained, so it's good. I don't know.
That's a question usually appeals more to restaurants. And what about exterior lighting? Are you going to have any extra lighting for any reason?
No.
I didn't think so. Okay. Now we'll get on to, you wanted two signs. Why do you need two signs?
I don't need two signs. So I don't know if I made an error in there. I'm okay with one sign.
And where would you like that one sign?
I was thinking like kind of like those political signs, a little sign in the front, how people do them in the yard. We don't need any large signage. I mean, it's my mom's house, and she wouldn't be comfortable with two.
A little two by.
I mean, yeah, maybe even like a sandwich board sign.
Yeah, we don't like sandwich boards. We'd rather have you have a.
Okay, well, yeah. Whatever kind of sign you all are comfortable with is good for me.
Well, if the board approves the conditional use, they would be eligible for a 20 square foot double faced freestanding sign 20 feet from the right of way, and they would be allowed to put up a 6 square foot temporary sign, which is what we would traditionally call a sandwich size board. That would be permitted by the code.
You mean both or one?
Both.
And what are the, quickly, what are the rules about the sandwich thing?
They're allowed only during the operation of the business.
Okay.
So in the morning, the sign could go up and then be taken down when the door's closed, at the end of the day, during the day, whatever the case may be.
Or it's not very practical, honestly.
Yeah.
No,
I'm comfortable with whatever signage you would allow. And I don't foresee it being anything that large, because it is my parents' residence, and they probably wouldn't like a big huge sign, so whatever you are comfortable with, I am.
And what would you like the sign to say?
Rochester Yoga Preschool.
Okay. And would you want that lit?
No. Just no, I don't think so.
Why wouldn't you say Penfield Yoga?
I started it in the city, so who knows? You never know. Rochester Yoga Preschool of Penfield. Maybe it'll say
Pen Rock. Let's see. Okay, now I have several letters somewhere from various neighbors, and I'm not going to read them all, but they all say that they do not have a problem with having your business there. I don't even think I'll read all the names, but there are 9 of them, and we will enter them into the record.
Okay, great.
Okay. I think that's about all, unless you have any questions for us.
Thank you. Any other questions for the board?
Yeah.
You do?
Yeah. Are you going to do anything with regard to traffic controlling? Are you going to do anything as far as directional? Are you going to have one side for entering, one side for leaving? Or?
I absolutely could, and that's a really good idea. So, yeah. Yes, especially if you want me to. I'll do it. Well, that sounds great, and I can tell the parents, please come in on this one side. I think that's a great idea, just for the smoothness.
Yeah, otherwise you could have, you know, people entering at the same time
absolutely.
In different directions than with parked cars.
Absolutely.
You're gonna have some problems, I could say so.
Good idea.
But nobody's gonna be out there normally in the morning?
If I needed to be, I would, but they're the same people over and over, so I think once I tell them this is the way we do it, it would be fine. And I can be out there as much as needed.
Do you have a similar situation in your current location?
Current location has, it's on University Ave, but it faces Atlantic. It's a little parking lot, and actually there are only 2 spots in front of the part where we are, and people usually just pull up and come in and drop off, or seems to be fine, because they do come in on a rolling basis between 9 and 9:15, even up to 9:30, and it just works out. No one ever has issues with parking.
So you have less flow where you are than you would have here?
I think so. I mean, it's different, because it's more of a square-shaped parking lot, but, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone in the audience care to speak about this? Come on up.
Hi, my name is Grace Kostich-Schlageter. I'm a longtime resident of Penfield. I am also an educator, retired, and also a person who thinks yoga is extremely important and spent time with yoga in my past. I'm concerned about this for a couple reasons. Is this classified as a preschool? And if so, what are the requirements from the state in order to have a preschool situation in this particular instance? Now, I also have a question about, you say that parents volunteer. Is this one parent at a time, or is this going to be like a mommy and me class where 12 cars pull in, some of them in the driveway, some of them on Creek Street, wherever, and stay for the entire class? Because you said there were no employees. So parking is a real concern as far as I'm concerned about this. A class of 12, I would think you would need more than one person assisting you. I mean, children of that age, especially if you're going to be doing a yoga class. Yoga classes require a good deal of concentration on the part who is teaching the class, because you have to look at what the children or anybody doing yoga is doing in terms of they're using their body correctly, and is there a possible damage to the child. So I think there needs to be some question about the number of people who will be responsible for this. I understand this drop off and so on. If you have a problem with the parking, it wouldn't surprise me. I'm concerned too about this. I have a question. This property apparently belongs to one person. It's going to be used by another. Are there rental payments going to be made in terms of this situation? In other words, is this becoming a rental property? And if so, is that within the limits of the town's ideas of a school? A couple of other things that come to mind when I was thinking about this. I wrote my notes on a paper napkin. Not very organized here. There's a certain amount of concern about the children being outside, too. Fencing, I would certainly think, would be an important kind of thing. This is an extraordinarily busy street. The possibility of not having a person other than a parent outside when they're coming and going also raises questions in my mind. There is a sidewalk that goes through there, but that's also a situation which needs, I think, to be very, very closely monitored. This rolling arrival time, possibly that's okay. Walking distance, I would think there would need to be certain concern about people walking, even with the sidewalk. Are these people going to be sending their children down the street by themselves? I mean, is someone going to be out there monitoring what's going on? But I really think one of the major questions for me is, does this meet whatever state and local requirements there are for a preschool? Because it is a preschool. Maybe they have a yoga room, maybe they do yoga part of the time, but what are the actual necessity qualifications for running a preschool? Is this appropriate use? I would assume it's not a daycare center, it's a preschool, and what are the requirements of both local and state for that kind of thing?
May I ask why you say it's a preschool?
Isn't that the term you used?
Yes, she does use it.
Okay, but are you using it? In what sense are you using that?
I'm using it because I want to know if this meets the requirements for a preschool in terms of number of people responsible for the children.
So you're using that term in the way the state would use
it. That's right, or local. Are there local?
Whatever the authorities are, okay.
Yes, whatever the authorities are, and I would like to know if this meets those requirements.
Sure.
I'm also concerned about the fact that this is being used, not the person who owns the property, but the a person who does not own the property is using this. Is there going to be rent paid for this, or is this, no. I mean, it sets a precedent for, I think, a variety of things. I have nothing against yoga. I have nothing against children. Take my word for it. Done both, been there, done that. But it seems to me as if there are serious questions that need to be looked at.
Yeah.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Yep.
Great.
Thank
you. Hi. So in terms of it being a preschool, it is a preschool program. And the New York State requirements are that if you run your program for over 3 hours, that it should be registered with the state. If it's 3 hours or less, then it doesn't need to be registered with the state. And the majority of preschool programs in this area are not registered with the state if they are half day.
Any other requirements from any other authorities, localities, the town, the county?
Not that I'm aware of, and I've been in communication with the Child Care Council of Rochester about this a lot since starting the program. But we actually do follow the regulations for space, number of children, number of adults, in order to make sure that we're still in compliance with it anyway. So,
well, let me just to clarify.
Yes. Yes.
I thought that you said if it's less than 3 hours.
Yes.
Well, are there regulations that apply even if it's less than 3 hours?
I'm not certain.
Okay.
I don't believe so,
Are you telling us that you follow the regulations that apply even if it were over 3 hours?
Yes, because just for safety's sake, and because I was at one point looking at, should I become registered anyway? Because you can voluntarily become registered even if you don't have to.
When are you planning to start this?
At this location in September.
Okay, so would you have, if we were to put this off for a month to investigate that point, is that something assuming that a month gave you enough time to be able to come in here in a month and say, hey, here are, and we could do it as well, here are the rules and regulations. None happen to apply because I'm less than 3 hours.
Yes.
Just to confirm that point.
Yeah.
Okay.
Absolutely.
And all right.
What were the other questions? I just want to address.
One of them was supervision.
So, as a preschool program, I'll have to bring that. I'll have to get all the information. But
yeah.
There is one parent who's a volunteer, so it's not a mommy and me class. We had one family this year who the mom stayed with her daughter for the first 2 months, so sometimes we would have two parents if she wasn't the signed up volunteer, just so that it helped her daughter feel comfortable. But it's not a mommy and me class, so it shouldn't be a whole bunch of cars.
Set up a schedule for the parents?
I do.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you're sure there's always going to be one?
There will always be at least one.
Okay.
Would you have any issue with a condition of approval being that there be no parking on the road?
Oh, I'm totally comfortable with that.
Okay.
Yeah.
And how about requirements that to monitor the drop-off?
Who's
going to let their three-year-old out of the car and say, see you later? You should have a rule that says parent or caregiver
absolutely
must escort the child.
And that's perfect, and we do anyway. They always come in with their children and help them get their shoes off and hang up their backpack, and then the same, they pick up at the door, they come in. But I can definitely have it be a written rule, you know. And parents always come in with their kids to drop them off or to pick them up. So I don't foresee anyone walking down the street to come by themselves, and it wouldn't be, I can make that a rule.
And I think one of the important things to bring up is that this isn't a brand new business for you. You've been doing this already, and it's established. You kind of know the ins and outs of what to expect, how many people you need, how many kids you have. And I think that's good to say that, there already is a precedent that you know what you're doing a lot of this already.
Thank you.
The last question, I think, was about the rent. And let me ask Harold. This is obviously a
mother-daughter, yeah.
Well, but this is a home, built as a home. Okay. Are there any rules about renting out a portion of the home to run a business, or allowing that to happen?
Nothing local, no.
But nothing that would prohibit that kind of arrangement?
There's nothing to prohibit you renting your entire house out to someone.
For a commercial purpose?
For commercial or residential.
As long as it's a permitted business.
As long as it's permitted use, correct.
Okay, I wanted that, you know, okay. All right. I mean, I understand that if we had a residential neighborhood and everybody starts renting the houses out for businesses, then we've kind of converted it from a residential neighborhood to a commercial one. But, you know, I don't think that's what we have here, but is it the start of something? That's a fair question to ask.
You might as well just clarify, too, there's going to be no exterior changes other than maybe adding a sign. But other than that, you're leaving the house the way it is, externally.
Yes, and maybe the fence in the back, something like that.
Yeah, you better come up here, though, so they can hear you and...
This is my mom and the owner of the house.
Hi, I'm Christine Puschkin, owner of 1653 Creek Street. And I just wanted to state that my husband will be building front steps a little larger and they just need to be rebuilt right now. So he will be making that change. And also, I currently volunteer as her assistant, and her and I are always there in addition with the volunteer parent. So there's always three of us, a minimal, so.
Are you charging her rent?
A minimal amount. We haven't even come up with an amount yet. Just to cover the costs of electricity maybe being used, heat in the winter, air conditioning when it's hot, just so it doesn't cost me more, you know.
When your husband changes the steps or fixes them or whatever he does, will that still meet our setback?
Oh, yes, absolutely.
Okay, so they won't come out any further to the front than they are?
No.
Okay.
What provisions have you made for snow removal in the winter? What do you do now, and is that going to create a visibility problem?
My husband has a snow blower. He goes out there at 6 a.m., 5:30, and blows out the circular driveway sometimes twice a day this past winter. So it's not a problem. He's a contractor, and he just takes care of all those things. He's up before anyone.
So because of the good job that I'm sure he does with the snow blower, is it fair to say that the number of parking spots in July will be the same as in February?
Absolutely.
Okay. All right.
I just got one point of clarification. Did you prefer a fixed sign in the yard that didn't move, set in post, or do you want one that you can bring in and out every morning?
I'd rather have it fixed so we don't have to move it, but she might want it movable. So I don't know.
I mean,
I don't want to bring it. We can.
We have not discussed this.
Yeah, we haven't discussed this.
I'd prefer something that you move, I mean, so it looks like a regular home on the weekend, you know, and just put it out. I mean, once we have our parents established, you know, they know where to come and so.
Yeah, whatever she
we
wants.
We haven't discussed it at all.
They can tell us back when they come. What we're talking about is you're going to have to come back next month anyway. Not here, but it'll be in the back of the room before the meeting, and that's when we'll make decisions. But by that time, could you let us know what you prefer? Probably Mal's choice, but so you don't have to do it right now and tell us. Okay.
All right. Okay. Any other board questions?
I think Greg said another.
Yeah, why don't you stay up here to save yourself a few steps? Come on back up.
Yeah.
I mean, you can sit in the front row there.
Okay. Something just occurs to me.
Okay.
Grace Kastich-Schlager again. Would you please include in whatever research is done in terms of this, what are the fire safety issues that need to be consulted on a situation like this? What provisions will be made for fire safety? Does this house meet certain requirements of fire safety and that sort of thing for this sort of thing?
Harold, can you comment on that now? Or do you, go ahead.
If she's approved, she will be required to put in emergency lighting, exit signs, a fire extinguisher, and I, just based upon what I know the property, there are multiple locations to egress from the structure. So they have a number of things already there that wouldn't have to change. But they will have to put in the emergency sign like we discussed, the emergency lighting, or the exit sign, emergency lighting, and the extinguisher.
Is there more than one exit from the in-law portion?
Okay, I was particularly concerned about the ingress and the egress in case of a fire and also that sort of thing. If I think of anything else, I'll let you know.
Make it quick.
We're done with her. It's likely going to be, it'll be tabled. Yeah, that's great.
The parent is still living?
I don't, isn't the in-law portion vacant?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's, yeah, that was my question.
And I just wanted to make sure the in-law portion's not the portion that they were going to convert or the area that they were living in.
Wait, now the mother lives on the left side.
In a portion that would be the residence, and the in-law portion will be converted to this use.
Right, and obviously my question was double ingress and egress for fire on the in-law portion.
It actually has three of them, Mike. Front door, back door, and a way to get from the one apartment to the other, so there's three of them.
So then there's an upstairs also on the daycare side, is there an upstairs?
No, it's a ranch, but there's like a basement, but like an outdoor basement below, yeah.
Okay.
So it's just.
I just wanted to make sure there was nobody living up on top of it.
No, there's no upstairs, it's a ranch, yeah.
Okay, anybody else in the audience care to speak about this? Thank you very much. As I said, likely going to be.
Tabled,
so you're welcome to stay, but that's probably what's going to happen.
Will you send the specific questions about?
Yes, yeah. Can you leave the board?
Absolutely.
All right, great, thanks. Application number four, James Bramall, Bramall Architects, PC, 6459 West Quaker Street, Orchard Park, New York, 14127. On behalf of Limestone Development Company, LLC, requests an area variance from Article 3-3-41-B of the code to allow the construction of an addition with less setback than required at 100 Elderwood Court. The property is owned by Limestone Development Company, LLC, and is zoned MR. This is SBL number 125.03-2-55. This is application number 15Z-0021.
Bamel from Bamel Architects at 6459 West Quaker Street in Orchard Park. We are here tonight to talk about the addition that's being proposed at the Heathwood at Penfield Assisted Living. And the reason we're even here is because of funding requirements that may allow any development in the future for any other piece of land that they currently own. Typically being through HUD is the way they've been financing, does not allow independent housing, which is the future plan for anything that they may consider here in their master plan, to be associated with anything with a memory care assignment to it. The intention behind the addition here in the assisted living is to expand their services in what the market is demonstrating in this area, which is 24 more beds of what they have, and then 20 the same thing with the first level stages of memory care. Virtually no difference, just a little more attention. That will be on the first floor, the memory care unit, and then the additional 24 units on the second floor. So it'll be a two-story addition to match in proportion and basically all the materials of the existing building. When this parcel was rezoned, I think it was 2008, there was a setback requirement of the entire boundary of 80 feet. As a buffer to the residences. By virtue of having to place a line along a parcel that still allowed enough land for us to place the additional units, and trying to shift the building as much as possible, we have a small portion in a radius of 80 feet that still touches that 80-foot arc. It actually happens in this portion here. It gets to a dimension of slightly over 65 feet in the setback. And in that particular area, we would be adding additional buffering to the nearby residents, mostly in the undergrowth. The tree canopy is there, but we'll do things underneath. And we've actually did through the owners caring, did have our own little neighborhood meeting that they did put out notices to say we want to make sure everybody knows what's happening. Nobody did attend, but the effort was made for them to do that. We were before the sketch plan review last week, and there were a few members here from the town who were neighbors in the area. I think somebody was actually over here. I don't know where the other people live, but had a couple comments. The owner of this facility did help them take some trees down. Now there's a hole, so he's asking if they can put some trees in there. And they said, sure, we'll help out with that too. And somebody else asked if there's any way we could ask the ambulances to turn their siren off as they approach the building. It's probably a large undertaking, but we will make the request. So we are asking for the variance tonight.
Can you talk a little bit about the site plan and why the whole entire building couldn't be shifted more to the east to avoid any of this? Are there any characteristics with the lot that make that something you can't do?
There are two particular issues, and we've been through about four different iterations. The first time we came in sketch review, we did have the building up further, but pushed it back, trying to mitigate this, make it even less. The topography of the land falls further to the west, to the point that there's an additional story. So we even have a basement under this, and the expense gets quite great. Plus, there's also wetland development in that area. And where we are placing the continued fire access drive around here is as tight as we can make it. And we initially had the land parcel cut way off when we segmented it straight through here. The first time we came in, we went to the Mylar portion with that. That's now going to be revised to allow for this to happen. In addition to that, the existing building where we make connection is right on the first floor where we have the most public part of the building, where anybody in the addition can also get to those public areas immediately instead of having to come through a bedroom wing.
Okay. So more than off to the east, wetlands are really prohibiting you from
east,
building
right
in, that, or,
east side, yes.
In that area. And then just the construction of the existing building doesn't allow you to connect really anywhere else to make it a logistical good move, I guess, in
correct.
A sense.
Yeah. And we do use all the same shared services for the kitchen, laundry, and any other basic utilities out of the existing building. So this building is not a freestanding operating piece. It truly is an addition by function.
Okay. Right now that's fairly wooded, and it gives the appearance that you would never see it. Do you know roughly how many trees would be left after that's taken down in terms of, if when you build that, are most of the trees that the neighbor sees where he can't see the building right now, would most of those be gone? And it would definitely require some kind of buffer put in there?
We would do it regardless. But
okay.
in looking at it, at what's there, it's undergrowth that's missing. And there's a canopy that starts at about 16 feet for the first probably 20 feet off his property. After we come through with the drive there, we'll just continue from that drive edge up.
Okay.
And fill in the undergrowth.
So as a condition, if we put on there just to have a natural buffer that's maintained,
so then
that adjacent property can't see the part that you're asking for the variance, you'd be basically fully in support of that? That'd be fine with you?
It's in our site plan now, yes.
Okay, perfect. Yeah. That's all I've got.
Any other questions from the board?
No.
Anyone in the audience care to speak about this application? Okay, very good.
Okay.
Thank you.
You need this for any reason, or do you have that?
So I'm sure someone at the town has it, don't we?
I believe that's one of the submissions that we have here at the town. Thank you for asking that.
Thank you.
Application number 5, Manish Sanin, DDS, 2214 Penfield Road, Penfield, New York, 14526. Requests a special permit for signage under Article 7-7-3 from Article 7-7-13-B. And Article 7-7-13-C of the code to allow greater building mounted signage and more than one building mounted sign at 2214 Penfield Road. The property is owned by M Squared Development LLC and is zoned BNR. This is SBL number 140.01-1-7.4. This is application number 15Z-0022.
Good evening. My name is Manish Sanin. I'm a dentist at the Smile Center located at 2214 Penfield Road. I'm the owner of M Squared Development, the holding company of the building and property. We're requesting the board to consider adding an additional sign to our building. The primary reason for this is we've been in this building for almost a year, just a little under a year. In that time period, we've had considerable confusion in many of our existing patients, many of our new patients, in finding us. The primary confusion is due to the front of our building, the entryway of our building. This is a picture of it. Very nondescript, no signage. Our signage is facing Penfield Road. In other words, facing due south, where all the traffic is. However, our front entrance is through the parking lot, as you see here. Again, no signage. Many of our patients end up utilizing the cross-access way, which connects our building to Penfair Plaza, to the post office. Anyone from Webster or coming south on 250, many of these patients are told our location for the first time. Typically, my office staff will say that we are located directly between Aldi's and Eastside Urgent Care, which we are. As a result, most of them know where we are as far as general geography, and they'll cut in through the cross-access way connecting Penfair Plaza to our building. Problem is they'll come down the road. This is what they see. They end up missing us. They end up missing us. That puts them either directly into the congested Penfield Road, or they end up looping around urgent care or going into urgent care or La Bella Spa, thinking that's where we are. We've collected about 400 signatures of patients of ours who have endorsed our application for additional signage for that main reason. It's created patients coming late to their appointments in addition to missing their appointments entirely. Our proposed signage is as such, that was probably sent to the packet that you guys have, 9.5 feet by 3.5 feet. It's going to be a reverse channel backlit halo sign similar to what we have on the other side of the building. The signage again is going to be on the front facade, which would face our parking lot. Beyond our parking lot is a drainage pond. Beyond that is about 400 yards of green space. So the signage should not affect any homeowners or create any unnecessary glare. That's our request.
The 400 patients you have signed are patients that are current patients.
They are current patients. Many of them are new patients. Many of them are patients who had trouble finding us. Some of them are even delivery drivers who have trouble finding us.
But now they know where you are.
They do.
Okay. The problem I have with this is I don't see why it's necessary to enhance the business identification. Your address is on Penfield Road, is it not?
Correct.
And on Penfield Road, you have a freestanding directory sign type sign and a building mounted sign on your property.
We have a directory for the plaza, for the urgent care plaza. Correct.
And you have a building mounted sign.
Correct.
And you have a driveway or roadway right next to you, which
correct.
Leads directly into your parking lot in the back. And you have a directional sign directing people into your parking area.
Correct.
So if your staff is advising people to come through the plaza, maybe they should stop doing that for new patients. I don't see why anybody would be seeking to use that access road to locate your business initially. They'd be looking for an address on Penfield Road where you clearly have identification.
Our town's motto is planned progress. That's why we've created these cross-access ways, I would believe. If someone wants to deliver a package at the post office, get their banking done at Bank of America or Citizens, pick up the subway, go to the strong primary care office, and then get their teeth cleaned. Part of planned progress, I think, is also identifying a small business. Our front facade is about as nondescript as it can be. You're driving down here, especially many of our elderly patients. We cater a lot to dentures and implants, and most of those patients are elderly. They're driving by, especially when the snow is 4 feet high. They have no idea what building we are. We can't tell them how to get to us necessarily, whether they use the cross access, but again, planned progress. That means, why did we create those cross accesses? I had to pay for the cross-access between urgent care and Tim Hortons. Again, that's to allow people from Tim Hortons to potentially go to the doctor. So I think easing that confusion for a nondescript building would help my patients. It's created confusion already in the year we've been there.
When I do that cross-access, and this was the same in the fall, and even more so now that the leaves have started to come on the trees, you got blockage. I mean, that's about the only angle that you could look directly into that face. If you're coming from Aldi's in that general area, you have foliage there that blocks the direct area where that sign is. And about the only time that becomes visible is when you're right on that driveway where the directional sign directs you into your office.
You're talking about this foliage here?
Yeah.
No, it's very low. It's a drainage pond. It's all set very low.
That was 15 feet high.
That hasn't been my experience.
It would not impact this area whatsoever.
I think it impacts it directly, and I drove it a couple times.
I'm there every day.
Okay. That's all the questions I have, Dave.
Questions for the board?
I'll actually second it. I actually didn't find your location because of the trees until I went around them, and that's when I first saw it. That's because of the foliage there from your, you know, from that retention pond with those tall.
Right in here?
Right there, yep.
But again, our. The signage we're requesting is up high.
All right, I know. I didn't even see the, you know, I'm just echoing what he was saying, that, you know, those trees really are blocking that. One idea that I did like back there is how Labella Spa, the urgent care, they all have their sign right there on the road. As you pull in, you know exactly where you are on the roadside, and that's where you pull in. I thought that was a very clever idea of what they've used right there, as opposed to putting something on their building. You know, you're driving along the road and you see it pulling right in then.
We requested that as well, and we were told specifically we were only allowed our directory sign and one attached sign, no other signage.
But so. you just said, where the picture that you have right there with the snow and pointing towards the back of your building, right?
No, I mean, the front of our building.
Well, which yeah, the front that? Of your front back, I know. Your back, your front from where the parking is, it's the actual back from Penfield Road, correct?
Correct.
Okay. Just past that is, like Mike said, is you have a little sign that directs you right into your parking lot, right? I mean,
correct.
it was kind of cut off, but
in winter you don't see it because, again, the snow, that's where the snow ends up being. So this entire winter, at least from December through until March, that sign was really not helpful whatsoever. This was taken around in April or about a month ago when we still had some snow. That sign is only yay high, so.
Okay, that's what I saw.
Blocked by 4 or 5 feet of snow all along this entire corridor in here.
Harold.
So again, a lot of our elderly patients, they miss us because there's no description to this building. And again, alluding back to, you know, our town's motto of planned progress, we're going to be confronting this, and I talked to the supervisor about this as well. All those houses on Penfield Road, as they convert over to businesses, they're going to be entered by a cross-access driveway. Each one of those businesses is going to need some sort of signage to direct people into their respective businesses.
But then I guess my other question is, why are you asking for total signage that's larger than allowed?
No, it's within.
No, it's 10 square foot more. Your allowed building signage of 110 square foot. And if you add that second one, it will be 110, I think 0.3 or something square foot.
Well, I do want to clarify something because your application referenced a 114-inch wide sign, which is a little bit bigger than the 9.5 that you just made representation to. So that changes the calculations a little bit relative to the total square footage of signage that you're asking for between the front and the rear sign. It doesn't change the fact that you're asking for two signs. It just changed the total square footage. You're still over. It's just that, but not as much as what you would have been at the other dimension that you gave us.
Okay.
Are you understanding what he's saying?
Because no, and I do, and I'm totally adequate with reducing the size of the sign so as to fall in the parameters that they need to be. My main focus is increasing the visibility of our building for our patients. So hopefully they arrive on time and they know where we are.
So it was just arbitrary that you asked for more square footage than you were allowed?
No, I think it was initially when we applied for it, I thought it was within the allowed amount given the square footage of our building.
No, you're allowed one sign totaling 100 square foot of building mounted signage. You want two signs totaling 110.3 square foot.
Well, that was based on a different calculation. What he just represented brought it down to 103. It's still more than the 100 that he's allowed, but
not as much.
Not as much, right.
Okay.
And obviously, I need that for the resolution because I have to be
precise
in the resolution. But
then it still begs my question, why would you ask for even 103 square foot if you only are allowed 100? I mean, I know you want the second sign, but you're asking us, give me a second sign and give me something even bigger than if I put two up.
Then we'll scale it back. I have no problem with that.
Okay.
Dan, I wanted to address the last point you made about the plan progress and the access roads. What we're looking at is something that this particular location has that most rear access road locations would not have. And he's talking about all access roads are going to have this problem with the rear, with the second sign. My answer to that is, if that's the case, then it would be up to our town board to pass legislation, if they felt it necessary, which allowed all buildings on access roads to have a second building mounted sign. They haven't done that. So I think, you know, it's sort of an argument. He's basically arguing against his position.
What the town board is, yeah.
I know.
Interesting. Harold, would he be allowed to put numbers up there to identify the address?
Absolutely, yeah.
What size?
They would be required to be at least 5 inches.
Could he put 10-inch numbers up there?
I don't know of anything that would prohibit 10-inch numbers, no.
Okay.
I mean, the codes, whether it be the fire codes, the property maintenance codes, and their local ordinance, require that they be visible.
Mm-hmm.
So the expectation is they're going to be large enough to be visible from, obviously, emergency services approaching the property.
Right. Do you have numbers on the other side?
They're on the directory side.
Not on
the front facade of the building. We have them on the door, on the window door, you know, for our mailman and whatnot, so he knows exactly what we are, because that's where the front entrance to the building is. The directory pylon that is on Penfield Road right here, that indicates us, the spa, and urgent care has the numbers.
But that certainly would be one way. If people come to your address and had your address and plugged it into their GPS, like people are prone to do nowadays.
Most elderly patients get
I understand that.
Don't.
I'm just providing you with a solution that may solve a part of your problem in any event. Okay. Any other board questions?
Nope.
Anyone else in the audience care to speak about this? Okay. Thank you very much.
Did that gentleman just leave that was sitting right there in the middle?
Yeah, he talked to me.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because I know he was interested in the application. I know he's been going in and out with his daughter. So.
He thought the signage was going to be on the other side.
Yeah, and he's on the other side of Penfield Road. Okay.
Okay, that was the last hearing. So their hearings are adjourned. We'll take a brief recess and reconvene in the back of the room. Thank you very much, everyone. We've had our recess and we're ready to reconvene. So let's go to the agenda, application number one.
Yeah, that one's mine. This is, again, sometimes what we have where no matter what we do, it's not going to make everybody happy. So, but that's what we get paid for. I mean, I empathize with the people who own the shed. They tried to do everything correctly, and yet we have a situation. And I empathize with the people who bought the house because they were, I hate to use the word misled, but they were a little bit like it was definitely going to be moved.
Well, but you know what? The more I heard about that, the more that person may have even believed it at that point, because efforts, it seems like, were certainly being made.
Yeah, right. So I guess what I'm saying is, there, you know, what are you going to do? But in the overall picture, I'm going to make a motion to approve this.
Can we make a motion for the seeker first?
My big speech and I missed the seeker.
I'd like to do it again.
Yeah, this is a type two action.
Okay, so we have a motion that this is a type two action with no further seeker needed. We have a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, so then to get back to what I said, I'll make a, yeah, so.
Joe, before you make a motion, could we find out what happened between the two groups, between the applicant and the other one about the shed when he said they could probably address it?
You mean the builder?
Yeah.
The builder's not here.
Between the two of them. No, but they were going to have the applicant address it.
Yeah, that's the liability issue.
Yeah.
You can answer that question.
Yeah, we tried to work with Rick Herman, the CEO of Homorama, when Homorama was being built, and Rick was very gracious, and I was willing to try to get it moved at that time. Rick had several of his contractors come out and work at the shed, and in the end, all of them declined to move it for liability reasons. They were afraid of damaging the yard, the structure itself, and all of them declined.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, that makes another reason why I think my motion is right. I make a motion to approve it. And your site?
I talked with Pete about the possibility of putting a condition that if they ever remove it, that it not be replaced unless it were in compliance or they received another variance. I mean, I can't imagine you guys ever removing it, but...
Sure, I can add that.
Yeah.
Is there a possibility that they could buffer that some way so that it wouldn't be so...
I would say not on their side because they only had 3 foot. But I see that they do have buffering on the other side of the fence that I think eventually will grow high enough.
Yeah, but they need more.
They got to bring stuff in and out, too.
Yeah, right. That's what I'm saying. If you restrict the space on the area where they're putting the furniture in, you'll never be able to get in there. That's why I was asking why that fence went up so quickly. You know, maybe I would even held off on a fence before, you know, at least if it was capable of being moved, they could still move it. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden there's a wrought iron fence, you know, so. And I guess the rest of my reasons too is that if they move it back, it is a prohibitive cost, okay? Because now the wrought iron fence is there. And if you move it back, I don't think you're going to not see, you're going to miss, if they move it back to the proper length, you'll cut off like 2 foot of the shed. So it's not going to really change the visual effect.
No, it's so big that it's really going to hit
not the visual effect in the neighborhood.
I agree with you.
So those were my reasons.
Somebody brought that point up during the hearing, too.
It's not going to be.
And that's why we talked about the setback has many reasons for a setback rule, but honestly, visual isn't really.
Yeah.
It's more maintenance and safety issues.
You're right. So again, I make the motion to accept the variance.
Awesome. It hasn't already been.
Further discussion? All right, we have a motion to approve in at least 1 second.
With conditions, right?
Right.
With conditions.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Okay. Good luck.
Thank you.
Where are we? Number... What's next? Two was withdrawn. What's
number three?
No, I think it's a sign. Is there anybody else?
Oh yeah, yeah. Who else is here? You want to do the Dennis first?
Whoever's here is
Dennis.
What are we doing? So yeah.
Yep.
That's what I thought.
Well, this is the application. I think the first time I moved to deny, and I haven't heard anything tonight that leads me to change my opinion. I don't think it's necessary to enhance the business identification. And I don't think it actually would enhance the business identification because of the fact that you can't see it. And I think basically based on the fact that there's a Penfield address for this property, and there's only one way you can go from that driveway, and that's there's only one entrance onto the parking lot. And that's in the back, and it's clearly marked both ways. And coming from that cross access, I can't see anything until you get to that sign.
And until the town board makes different decisions.
Then I think, you know, just the mere fact that a building has a cross access in the rear doesn't entitle them to a second building on the sign. I think we need legislative action to change that rule, and they haven't done it at this point. So For those reasons, I would move to deny this.
Second.
It's also an unlisted action.
Can we go back to that?
You blew it too. Secret.
You sensed that coming.
See, Harold was ready to pounce.
Yeah, I was going to try to give you an out.
I know, yeah.
So we haven't taken any action other than discussion. So it's there's a motion that's unlisted and no significant impact. Second on that?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, and then on the merits?
I reiterate my motion to deny for the reasons I gave.
And I'll reiterate my second.
Okay. I guess the only thing I would add to it, I'd like to add, is that the arguments that we've heard tonight are valid concerns.
Absolutely.
But nothing that I saw that was unique to this property in instances where we've said no before, to be honest. So, okay. Anything else? Any other discussion, Carol?
No, I was going to say that putting the number, I think you had a good idea, putting the number in.
No, would you say that again, Carol?
Yeah, right. She choked on it the first time.
But I do think that that's a good idea if you put the number up large so people can see it.
Yeah, one foot letters would be, it would go with the scale of it, too.
Could even go on a lower roof.
Yeah.
All right. So in any event, we have a motion to deny in a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Number three.
You want to table that one, Dave?
That's right.
It's mine.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't have to go to this till the next time, right?
No. Yeah, actually, do we have to do secret before we table?
Can we just knock it off and tell them?
You could take care of secret now, or you could wait.
Okay, well, it's unlisted anyway, so there's no
significant. Okay.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And I move that we table until next month to give the applicant and the town or whoever time to come up with any local, state, local, or any kind of regulations concerning these preschools. Also, to give them time to decide upon a sign and to check on fire safety items that we mentioned.
How about the fence? Do we need anything more on the fence, or was it?
Yeah, I thought we put that in as a fence.
Well, she did say something about a temporary fence.
She talked about putting a temporary fence up, regardless of something like.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I think when we do the final resolution, I'd like to put that in.
Yeah.
So if she has any further information about that, I think. I'm sorry, go ahead.
I apologize. I was just going to say, you saw her backyard. It's huge.
It is huge.
So, I mean, if she just put a temporary fence up, like a snow fence or something, where the children have to knock it down, right, and she can take it down.
Because of her business.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I agree.
And she has 12 kids there. That's a lot of kids for one person and a parent.
And I agree. I just meant temporary rather than permanent, you know, so it doesn't mess up.
I think we can just put that as a stipulation. If you have kids out back, you need some kind of barrier to protect them from going on the street.
I'm going to do that in the resolution.
If they don't go out back, they don't have to.
Yep.
So let's make sure that we're clear on what we're asking. What do we want to see from her to satisfy us that she has or will comply with all applicable
state
regulation?
Rules,
any
what if that should be a condition in the approval?
Sure, as it typically is, but I we put it off for a month to get something more than that, and she agreed to do it, so some authority, even if it's an attorney or representative saying she's exempt and here's why. I think she's looking for us, for the tabling motion, to be specific about, and rightfully so, what exactly it is that we want. And just when you talk to her, just want to make sure that we convey it to her so we're not tabling it again next month.
Well, I think we need to know how many people she needs to supervise, however many kids she's got. There must be some kind of limit somewhere on that.
Well, I think that's the key right there, because if the state is going to license her under the regulations, and they're going to say you need 5 staff members, that may be a significant number of employees that may compel the board to change a decision process.
Probably change her mind, having to pay.
I don't know, right. But the board can't change what state regulation is. So
right.
The expectation is she's going to comply with all state and local codes.
No, I totally get that.
I think it's a good point that we need to know if she has to have additional employees, it may change the outcome of the decision.
Or if she just comes in and says, I promise or I swear or whatever to go by all the state regulations, is that good enough?
Yeah, what if the state regulations permit her to have 50 kids and up to, you know, 25 adults?
It doesn't seem logical for the licensing to be based solely on the length of time the classes are, in my mind.
No, they do.
So you could have 200 kids?
There may be more than one.
That's what I'm saying.
There may be more than one threshold, let's say.
There's different thresholds, that's right.
But the time has to do with like half-day, you know, kid full day, all that sort of stuff.
I'll sort of...
But it's got to be a number of kids, square footage, sure.
So there's got to be other criteria that she has to meet, whether she's licensed or not.
Yeah.
And that's what you had asked, I think.
Yeah, yeah, whether there are no rules because you're, you know, it's 45 minutes longer, and so therefore, there aren't any rules, even if you have 200 kids, who knows?
You know, and they still have regulations of how you're going to take care of these children, irregardless of whether or not you're getting licensed to them or not. The expectation is that you're providing a care.
It's kind of like daycare.
Okay.
Well, it's, even daycare has thresholds, so...
You know, and I know that the town doesn't necessarily like sandwich signs, but if the mother comes back and would rather just put a sign out in the morning, take it down when it's done, I think that would keep it a lot more residential.
I'm not going to say the town doesn't like sandwich signs.
Well,
it's permitted in code.
They don't like the fact that they're left up there longer than they're supposed to.
That's right.
That's right.
Put it that way, yeah.
That's our bigger...
And I think she brought the point that after a few weeks, they're not going to need to put it out there.
Yeah, because...
It's the same people coming back over and over again.
And a lot of times what we see with these types of uses is not necessarily... on a day-to-day basis, but when enrollment opens up, where they need to fill a spot, they'll put a sign that says, well, open enrollment now or something.
And I think her mother is going to not really want it to look like a business in front of her house. So
I sort of gathered that from...
Yeah.
All right, so I think we're clear on if she calls or whatever the table resolution will say so she can...
Yeah.
Great. Okay, that was number three.
Yep.
So what do we have left? Number four?
Tough one, Andrews is five.
Did they not vote on it?
So we didn't vote to say table?
The motion was made by Carol to table, and...
Yeah, second.
Okay, thanks.
Can we speak up?
Wait a minute.
Right, keep us honest.
All right, motion to table and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Very good, number four.
Let's see, for mine, we're going to do this right. Want to say it's type two action under seeker, there's no further action.
Well, he showed you guys up, didn't he? Oh, we're going to do it right.
Yeah. Gee, went out of four, ain't it?
That's right. I'm going to make a motion to grant the 17-foot variance.
Do we want to...
Okay, so we have a motion that is a type two action.
We didn't vote on it.
Right. So a motion that it's a type two action. And no further action under seeker required. And a second, all those in favor?
Aye.
And then I'll make a motion to grant the 17-foot variance with the stipulation that the adjacent neighbor to the north has some kind of buffer is installed that prevents line of sight to the area that we are granting the variance.
Which he said he'd do, right?
Which he said he would.
He said it's already incorporated into the site plan. Do you feel comfortable allowing the planning board and the landscape consultant for the planning board to make a decision on the type of...
I do, because I don't know an arborvitae from a palm tree.
And I think my stipulation is saying line of sight from the northern property, as long as you don't see it.
Yeah, right. And believe me, the planning board will make it right.
Okay.
I think, based on the property, the wetlands on one side, they can really only build a certain portion of it. And this really is the best plan for the site, so that's why I'm going along with it.
I'll second.
Okay. So we're seeing this kind of development more and more, aren't we?
Yeah, we are. You know, as people age and there's more people becoming almost older than are coming up young, I mean, this is really going to be a problem.
Living longer and, and needing care.
Yep.
Okay, so we have a motion to approve with conditions and a second. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All right. Very good. Well done, folks. How's June looking?
We have one adjourned, two tabled.
Oh, yeah.
And then got a conditional use permit for the small hold nursery, which is just going under new ownership, so, and then an area variance for a pool barn on like 2-point-something acres.
The area variance for the small addition?
Oh, right, the garage addition where they want to come a little closer to the road.
So it's like four that we have to hear, or five that we have to?
I'm gonna say there were four up there.
For some reason, I think it's five that we have to hear.
Okay, two back here.
Okay, simple.
Yeah, five is better than seven or eight.
Okay, well, then we'll stand adjourned until our next meeting. Thank you all very much.
Okay.
And we did all decide on Monday, then.